and that way you're constitutionally compliant. Nowadays, they say, yeah, you know what? We made a mistake back then. We're not allowed to tell you exactly how much because you do have the power of the purse, but only to some degree because we still get to tell you whether it's constitutional or not. So I can't tell you how much, but you need more money.
This is the Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Then I'll get on my knees.
I'm going to be really honest with you all. I really expected to be talking this morning about Roy Moore winning instead of Roy Moore losing. So this is a little bit off the cuff, more than I wanted it to be. But I'm really happy to say that my overwhelming feeling about Roy Moore not pulling off an upset victory. Well, Doug Jones pulling off the upset is probably a better way to say it. Is relief. Just overwhelming relief. And I'm going to tell you why. I think this is a very, very, very good thing, despite the fact that I really, really was looking forward to a couple more days of people screaming at the sky like they did after Trump's victory. So it was disappointing we're not going to get to see that. But I can't. My heart is not breaking that Roy Moore is not going to be a noose around Republicans' neck in the next couple of years. So let's talk about this. Dems won a battle last night, but I think this helps Republicans win the actual war. Roy Moore was going to be an albatross around the necks of Republicans, and we didn't need that going into 2018. There's a good opportunity that we're going to be Republicans. When I say we, I apologize. I am a Republican, and I used to be really proud of that fact, and now I'm kind of, I don't even know what that means anymore. But when I say we, I am talking about Republicans and specifically conservatives. I consider myself conservative. And one of my concerns about Roy Moore was that I'm not sure he's conservative in the way that is good for this country. And I'm going to give you some examples. And I'm taking these from a David French article on nationalreview.com, which if you are new to politics or the conservative movement or the Republican movement, I highly recommend National Review. I know the Republican Party is maybe at a little bit of a split, and Roy Moore is definitely a flashpoint in this debate between kind of populists and conservatives. And National Review has been around for a long time, and there's some great minds there. And David French he's become one of my favorites, even though probably a year ago I would have called him establishment, and I do not like the establishment. So he has written this article called The Comprehensive Case Against Roy Moore, and he wrote this before the election. And I know if you all are anything like I am, watching this election unfold was heart-wrenching. I really wanted to stick it to the media, and so it was emotional to watch, knowing that Republicans were in this position. I'll just say this, I do not envy Alabamans the choice they had in this election. It was truly, it was Sophie's choice. So, David French says there was a good case against Roy Moore based nothing on the allegations of sexual misconduct. Which we'll get to that in a minute, but let's talk first about some of the reasons he was going to be an albatross around conservatives next, regardless of all of that other stuff. First of all, David French says Moore believed he was a law unto himself. Now, I knew Roy Moore's name long before he became the Republican nominee for U.S. Senate, because back in 2003, he defied a federal court order they demanded that he remove a Ten Commandments monument from the Alabama Supreme Court building. Now, at the time, I thought a little defiancy was not a bad thing, and I still think that. Like, I am not a hippie, I've never burned my bra, but I'm not opposed to a sit-in or some civil disobedience when warranted. I was almost a kid then, so I didn't really think deeply about it. I just thought, yeah, Ten Commandments. Anyway, he refused to remove them, and then he was suspended for that from the Supreme Court. And by the way, the part that gives me pause about him refusing to remove them, the Ten Commandments from the courthouse, is that he commissioned them himself. It wasn't, they hadn't been there for 100 years. They basically came to the courthouse with him. And while I didn't agree with the federal court's decision to demand that he remove them, we have a rule of law, and he was an adjudicator of the law. I don't know how you serve in that position and not have a little bit of respect for the law above you. So the first time it was, I could live with it. And in fact, I kind of cheered it a little bit. Civil disobedience is sometimes necessary. My problem is he defied authorities again a second time when he refused to, he was on the Alabama Supreme Court, and he ordered that Alabama probate judges not issue same-sex marriage licenses. And that was after the Supreme Court had decided that the Constitution protected the right to same-sex marriage. Now, take that issue off the table and just look at it as we have a rule of law, and we have to determine our civil disobedience has to be measured and thoughtful. He twice disregarded the court above him, which there are lawful ways to protest federal court orders. There are even lawful ways to reverse and change Supreme Court precedents. So I'm not sure. I think in the conservative battles, you have to pick which hills you're willing to die on. And I'm not even saying he chose bad hills, but I'm saying if you're willing to die on every hill, maybe you shouldn't be in the position that he was in as a member of the Alabama Supreme Court. So here's how David French puts it, which is better than I'm putting it right now, which is, ironically enough, those who supported Moore because they hate judicial supremacy are endorsing the most dangerous form of judicial supremacy possible, a judge who actively defies controlling authority on the basis of his will alone. And that was a problem for me. And the thing is, this is the funny thing about the whole Roy Moore thing. Had the sexual allegations never been brought to light, I wouldn't have read this article. I wouldn't have even looked at it. And I do think that is one thing that killed the Moore candidacy more than the sexual allegations. It was the steady drip of people looking deeper, which they always were going to, but the steady drip of people looking deeper and then finding some things that were maybe a little bit difficult. And then I really think had the sexual allegations came out, he said in the worst interview I have ever seen televised, he went on Hannity. If you'll recall, the sexual misconduct allegations came out. Roy Moore went on Hannity and said, well, I always got permission from their mother. And it wasn't a full denial of what occurred. It was, he didn't do himself any favors. Had he gone away after that and decided, you know what, turns out I'm terrible on television. I'm terrible answering questions about this. I need to hide in a hole until December 13th. I'm convinced that he would be the incumbent or the senator from Alabama a few weeks from now. But he didn't. He was back out there in public. And so we had all this interest in him. So the national media was following him. Everybody was following him around. And he could not take his foot out of his mouth for 5 minutes. He said that he would like to go back in time to pre-Civil War when families really meant something. And I like to give people the benefit of the doubt. I mean, I agree that families used to be more important. But he talked specifically in that quote about Black families and how slavery families were stronger during slavery. And I'll tell you, maybe if you're watching me on Facebook Live, you may be able to tell I am a minority. I'm Black. And I know that not to be true. And I think history books, even if you don't have any history of it in your own family, tell you that it was not good on families. They didn't allow slaves to get married. They sold their children. They sold husbands away from wives. It's just not true. So he's maybe Roy Moore was a little bit of a historical illiterate, or he just didn't think very carefully about the stuff coming out of his mouth. And it's not good for Republicans when you have that guy who cannot take his foot out of his mouth long enough to accomplish anything. And then he continued to do that. A couple weeks later, days leading up to the election, he said they should have cut it off at the 10th, you know, after the 10th Amendment, we should have stopped. And I like to give him the benefit of the doubt. I think the founding fathers had things right and they knew what they were doing. And they felt like all of the stuff that we later amended the Constitution to say, I think they felt like they had it covered. And they did. But you can't say that because women weren't allowed to vote. You know, it allowed women to vote. It freed the slaves. I mean, you can't say that, Roy. You can't say that. And then finally, his campaign rally the day before the election. And it's important to note that in Alabama, they didn't have advanced voting. So he's making a final pitch to all voters in the day before they're going to the polls. And the only clips that I saw from this rally were a friend of Roy's from Vietnam who, and this is the thing, there's no media there asking him questions. They're just talking off the cuff. His friend from Vietnam gets on stage and says, you know, I know Roy's a good man because we went to a brothel. And when he realized it was a brothel, we left. Like, I'm not sure that helps your case that much. Why were you in a brothel to begin with? But okay. And then his wife gets on stage and says, and God bless her, the Alabama accent, which is never going to be my favorite. She says, you know, the media would tell you that we don't like Jews. Well, our attorney's a Jew. I'm like, oh, stop talking. So when we come back, we're going to talk a little bit more about this. Please give us a call if you'd like to weigh in. The number is 316-721-8255. We'll see you after the break.
This is the Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier on the Mid-America Network.
Broadcasting Network. My name's Danedri, and I am filling in for Andy Hoosier today while he is out hopefully doing something fun and exciting. And if I were him, I would be sleeping in because he gets up really early to be here. If you're just now joining us, if you went to bed at a reasonable hour last night, you may not know that Doug Jones, the Democrat, pulled off an upset last night in Alabama. That's what we're talking about. As I said at the top of the hour, my overwhelming fear, I wanted Roy Moore to win to give the media its comeuppance. However, I woke up this morning feeling a deep sense of relief that he didn't. I feel like it's better for the country and I feel like it's better for Republicans that Roy Moore stay at home in Alabama and Doug Jones go to Washington. He's only going to be there for I think he's filling the remainder of Jeff Sessions' term, which I believe Sessions was reelected to the Senate for like the 9 millionth time in 2014. And so in 2020, Doug Jones is going to be on the ballot again. And I don't think Democrats can take too much comfort in the knowledge that they won in Alabama against by 1.5 points to a man who was accused of sexual misconduct. And then Roy Moore is wacky. And that's what we've been talking about this morning. The concerns I had about Roy Moore going into this election last night. I don't have to worry about them anymore, but I think it's important that people know what the narrow dodge that Republicans received at the thanks to the people of Alabama. I'm not saying they made the right choice. I'm just saying Republicans were going to lose this election no matter what happened. Roy Moore won, they lost. If Roy Moore lost, they lost a Senate seat. So I'm talking about a David French article from National Review where he kind of lays out a case against Roy Moore. He wrote this before the election. And one of the things, probably the most disturbing thing about Roy Moore going into this election actually wasn't the sexual misconduct stuff. It was, I'm not excusing him. I'm not disbelieving the women necessarily, although I have trouble buying 40 years go by and you all of a sudden have this need to talk to the Washington Post about what Roy Moore did 40 years ago. It's shocking to me, especially considering Roy Moore had been a lightning rod in Alabama long, long before he ran for Senate. He was on the Alabama Supreme Court. He, defied federal court orders when he was a sitting justice on the Alabama Supreme Court. So this wasn't Roy Moore's first rodeo, and they had plenty of opportunities to bring this up. And quite frankly, it's a little disturbing that the Republicans, especially the establishment Republicans, and even what I would call the conservatives who don't maybe like Flair, supported different candidates. The establishment was supporting Luther Strange. The conservatives who maybe like conservatives don't like the establishment, but can't handle Roy Moore riding to the polls on his horse and shooting his gun at campaign rallies. Those folks supported Mo Brooks. So Roy Moore was not the darling of Republicans going into this. My biggest concern about him long before the election, and despite the sexual misconduct allegations, is that he said in 2006 in an opinion piece, he wrote that Muslim Representative Keith Ellison, I believe he's a Minnesota Democrat who serves in the House, Moore wrote, Ellison cannot swear an oath on the Quran and an allegiance to our Constitution at the same time. And the U.S. Constitution directly, unequivocally, and unambiguously says otherwise. It prohibits any religious test. So a lot of conservatives had great, grave concerns about Roy Moore, and they had those going into the Republican primary in Alabama long before any of the sexual misconduct allegations came out. So I do think Republicans maybe dodged a bullet. We were going to be wounded in this election no matter how it shook out. And I wanted him to win, I think. But the more I think about it, I'm really relieved that he didn't. And I'm going to give you a couple reasons why, other than he had some issues as anyway, policy issues that were of concern. But I think him losing might actually force congressional Republicans, and specifically the Senate, to accomplish something between now and the start of the year, because the Republican majority is about to be cut by one. It was always a narrow majority. The U.S. Senate is going to be 51-49 in January when Doug Jones is seated, and Republicans are in committee right now. Conference committee trying to hash out the details of this tax plan. And I don't know if you all are on Twitter or not, but you can learn a lot about what's going on if you follow a lot of people on Twitter. And I have seen whispers of concerns that the tax deal in Congress was breaking down a little bit. They're right now debating state and local taxes, or SALT, that deduction, which I actually think is critical to this tax bill. I don't love it, but I think it's perhaps the most necessary part, and I will explain that later. But Roy Moore not being there is going to force some of these Republicans to get on board when they may not have. So there are a few things that we can look forward to, knowing that Republicans maybe lost this battle in Alabama last night, but I think this actually helps us in the long run win the war. So give me a call if you'd like to weigh in on this. You can reach me at, well, the station, not me, at 316-721-8255 or 721-TALK. We'd love to hear from you. You're listening to the Andy Hoosier Show. I'm Danedri Herbert, and we'll see you after the break. Show. I'm Danedri Herbert, filling in for Andy Hoosier, and I hope he's sleeping in this morning somewhere cozy and still in bed. If you are just now tuning in, we have been talking, of course, about Roy Moore and how Alabama has sent or is sending a Democrat to the U.S. Senate for the first time in 25 years. I expected to wake up this morning and talk about Roy Moore winning. I mean, I really, almost from the day the sexual misconduct allegations came out, I thought, well, Roy Moore's going to win. No one's going to care. And for a while, the polls led me to believe I was correct. There was a poll probably 2 weeks ago that said 71% of Alabama Alabamans didn't believe any of the allegations, which just tells you how far the media has fallen as a as an institution in this country. I haven't decided yet whether I really want to talk much about the allegations. It's over, and I really kind of hope Roy Moore, goes to the Bahamas and maybe stays there. You know, he's lived a long, fairly good life and has done some good things, I'm sure, on behalf of the citizens of Alabama. But now it's time for him to maybe fade from public view and enjoy his retirement. So that's kind of my hope. I hope we're done hearing from Roy Moore. I hope we're done hearing from the women who are accusing him of things 40 years ago. Let's move on. And as conservatives and as Republicans, I think the most important thing to take away from this is that this was a battle, not the war. And losing this battle probably helps us in the long run. I do believe firmly that one of the things that has been holding the Democrats back, thank goodness, well, one of the things that have been holding the Democrats back for the last two decades has been Bill Clinton. They have been saddled with this weird sort of, we're for women, but Bill Clinton can do whatever he wants, I'll put my knee pads on for him situation. And it's time, I don't want Democrats to have the moral high ground. They don't deserve it. They don't deserve it. And had Roy Moore gone to the Senate, they would have a good chance of really being able to stick a stake in the high ground. And I, as much as they try, I think they have failed to do so for quite some time. And that's partially because of Bill Clinton. That's partially because of people like Ted Kennedy and even JFK. So this isn't a bad thing, even though it is going to cut into the Republican majority in the U.S. Senate. However, I think that's going to help. I really do. In the next couple of weeks, President Trump has kind of promised that he would like to see and sign, have on his desk before Christmas, a tax reform plan. And it is a massive tax cut for the middle class. I think we're seeing in the stock market that it is, people are hungry for that. And the Republicans in the Senate have been a little bit reluctant to do anything that Trump has asked. And I think this election is maybe going to scare them a little bit into getting on board with the things they need to do to ensure that they're electable come 2018 and that they can do something. So I think having one fewer Republican isn't going to hurt the Republicans, because they're going to have to work to get something accomplished. And I think that's what's going to happen. And here's the other thing. I don't live in Alabama, because I don't know how I would have voted in that election, but I can say for certain I would not have voted for Doug Jones. But he's going to the U.S. Senate, and he's going to have kind of two choices. I don't care what the Democrats say, how they try to spin this. They're calling it a referendum on Trump, and I think anybody with a brain can tell that is not what happened in Alabama. Trump was a sideshow in a crazy circus. And so Doug Jones is going to have two choices. He can govern as a scorched earth Democrat, go along with whatever Chuck Schumer says on any topic, or he can try and kind of govern from the center, or I should say legislate from the center. And I think his speech last night gave a little bit of an indication that that's the choice he's going to make. I'm not completely convinced that Doug Jones is going to vote with the Democrats on every single issue, because he is going to want to be reelected. I mean, I don't know anybody who goes to the U.S. Senate and says, you know what, I've done one term, this has been fun. And he's not even doing a full term. Nobody goes there and says, I've been there, that was fun, I'm leaving. They go there, and a lot of them choose to stay for as long as humanly possible. I give you Pat Roberts, and that's all I'm going to say about that. So Roy Moore is not going to be in the Senate, and the guy that is might actually vote with the Republicans on a few things, because I think he's going to get there and decide, you know what, being a U.S. senator is kind of cool. And the other thing is, there's my radio engineer just said, and Roy Blunt. Yes, true. There are quite a few people who have gone there and stayed forever. I think the average age of the members of the U.S. Senate is like in the mid-70s or something. I mean, it's crazy. They like it, and they stay. And so I do think Doug Jones is going to be up for re-election in 2020. He's not going to be able to go out on a limb too far if he has any hope of returning to the U.S. Senate in 2021. So there's some hope there. The other little bit of hope that I found in this disaster train wreck of a circus in Alabama is that the pro-life side has won the argument. I mean, it's still got to get through the courts, and it's still got to, I mean, there are some things that can't be done right now from a legislative perspective, but if the Doug Jones victory tells us anything, he won by 0.5. And by the way, I don't think I've mentioned this. Roy Moore has yet to step aside and accept the results of the election. So we may be in for a little bit of nonsense. But in the meantime, I do believe Doug Jones his victory is going to hold. But he only won by 1.5 points. And what does that tell you about the citizens of Alabama and other conservative areas of the country when a guy who is, I'm going to say, somewhat credibly accused of sexual misconduct and who is just, Roy Moore was bizarre, he's bizarre. When the Democrat can only win by 1.5 in that election, that tells you something about where the country is. It tells you something about where Alabama is. And I do think, I know I heard a number of people online, on forums, on talk radio saying, I just can't vote for Doug Jones because he's a liberal, insane, pro-abortion candidate. So this tells me that... we've won this argument. The pro-life argument, we have won it. And Democrats are going to have to decide if they ever want to have hold the reins of power again in the legislative branch and even in the a lot of state governments. They're going to have to break that stronghold of you must be pro-abortion up to the moment of, as long as there is a toe still on the birth canal, you have to be pro-abortion. I think they're going to have to break that if they ever want to get power back. And I think this Alabama election really, really shows this. And so I take a little bit of hope on that. I mean, had Roy Moore won, there would be no question. That is, in my mind, that's what propelled him. But the fact that Doug Jones could only squeak out the narrowest victory in this election in that sideshow tells me that pro-lifers have won that argument. And the other thing this tells me is that people, the media, no, people don't trust them. I mean, they don't trust them. And I should mention this. I am an editor at an organization called SentinelKSMO.org. We try to hold the media and government accountable. So when the Kansas City Star and the Wichita Eagle are out making stuff up, which they're wont to do, we write about what they missed, what they didn't get out there, and try to hold them accountable. But not every place has that, and even the places that do, it's hard to get some traction. The media does a wall of sound. That's definitely what they did in this Roy Moore race. They put everything out there. They threw it all out there on the field. And despite all of the media's best efforts, Doug Jones only won by 1.5 points. I mean, this is, the media is what I would call the gray area of this race. The fact that they were able to propel Doug Jones over the top is troubling. I think we might see more of, the sexual allegation stuff isn't done. And this kind of, it's upsetting. It's upsetting because the Roy Moore allegations were 40 years old. I mean, I haven't been single for 10 years now. My anniversary is actually in 2 days. Anyway, but I do remember being single and being stupid. I mean, I want the war on men to end, and I think this probably propels it further. So that was one thing I did want to talk about today, is the war on men. I hope it's obvious that I am a woman. As you're listening, I hope it's clear, but in case it isn't, I am female. I identify as female. So I feel like I can maybe say a few things about a ceasefire in the war on women. So my concern about Roy Moore, what happened in Alabama, what's been happening for a while, is that we're going so far now that we just believe the allegations. I mean, I cannot tell you the number of people said, well, we have to believe the women. And I'm here to say, no, you don't have to believe us just because we have ovaries. I mean, that's not a good reason to believe somebody. So I'm not saying they're lying. I'm really not. But I am going to say the hashtag MeToo, the movement, if you will, is concerning. I like men. I like to be treated as a female in the traditional sense. I am not going to be mad if you open a door for me or offer to pay for my meal or step in front of me if somebody's trying to rob me or, I like being a woman. I like having that relationship with some men where we can banter, and it upsets me that I think that's going to go away. And I think it's going to be harder for women in the long run to even get jobs, be promoted, because there's going to be so much fear. So I want to talk a little bit about that after the break. You're listening to The Andy Hoosier Show on the Mid-America Network. My name's Danedri Herbert. We're going to be back after the break to talk a little bit about Me Too. You can give us a call to weigh in at 316-721-8255, 721-TALK. Good morning. If you're just now joining us, you're listening to The Andy Hoosier Show. My name's Danedri Herbert. I should have mentioned this a full hour ago, but some of you may recognize me as Gidget Southway. I used to run an anonymous blog. The blog still exists, but I was outed by a Kansas City newspaper. So my I'm not anonymous anymore. I'll just put it that way, because apparently I can't say the appropriate word. I don't have it in me this morning. It's awfully early. Andy is somewhere on vacation, hopefully sleeping in. So you've got me this morning. We've been talking about the Alabama election results. I'm not going to spend that much more time on it, because you're probably sick of it if you're anything like me. I've had about enough. But here's what you need to know. The Democrat won last night. Doug Jones won by 1.5 points. He beat Roy Moore, who has not yet conceded the race. At least he hadn't the last time I looked at my handy internet. So it's over. Doug Jones is going to be in the U.S. Senate. His seat, he's taking the remainder of Jeff Sessions' term, which will be up in 2020. So he probably has a very short stay in the U.S. Senate unless he figures out how to work with Republicans and maybe moderate his liberal views. I mean, he ran as a dyed-in-the-wool Nancy Pelosi liberal in Alabama. And so I just have trouble believing that that is going to fly past this one half of a term unless he moderates. So there's some good news there. There's some good news moving forward, and that this is going to force Republicans to have to work a little faster on tax reform, which is a good thing, because the Senate majority is they're losing a seat. It's going to be 51-49 come January. So they need to spend some time getting their ducks in a row before that happens. And I think this loss of one seat is going to encourage them to work faster and work harder so that Americans can have some tax relief. In the meantime, here is the very dark spot in this Roy Moore loss, other than just losing a Senate seat. That hurts a little bit. But the media is going to try this again. They dug up dirt or made it up. I don't trust the media, and I don't think most people do anymore either. But they're gonna try this again, and they're going to try it again from the war on men perspective, and I hate to see that. It is getting so uncomfortable and so difficult to have relationships between the sexes. It's getting hard. It's going to be open season on men, and I mean I think it has been ever since the Harvey Weinstein allegations, but I think it's going to continue, and I think it's probably going to get worse before it gets better. This makes me sad. In case it's not obvious, I am a woman. I identify as a woman too. I don't believe the fallacy that you should just believe the women just because they're women. So this is about to get difficult. The Me Too, hashtag Me Too movement has, I have a few concerns with it. I said in the last segment, I like men and I want to be treated like a woman. So I'm not looking forward to that. The other thing is, where does a man go to get his reputation back if a woman has trashed it? Where do you go? I don't know what to say about Roy Moore, but assuming he's innocent, if he in fact is, where does he go to get his reputation back? His reputation of sexual misconduct and integrity, where does he go to get that back? He can't. He cannot. And so that concerns me for my male friends. The other thing is, in the long run, I think this is bad for women in general. If I were a man, I would think the woman doesn't have to be as good as the man that he's interviewing. You know, if he's interviewing a man and a woman for a job, she has to be a lot better than him. Because if I'm a man making a hiring decision, I'm going to be really reluctant to even take the risk. And that's concerning to me. The other little bit of the Me Too movement that is incredibly concerning to me is that this hashtag Me Too, I don't know if you all are on Twitter, when it was really blowing up, I mean, every woman in America was hashtag Me Too. And I can honestly say hashtag Me Too. I don't know any woman who has never been in the presence of a creep. I mean, they're out there. And you just, I hate that the creepy guy who maybe lingers a little too long with his hand somewhere is being considered the equivalent of sexual assault. They're two different things. The creepy guy, you say, don't touch me again, and we all move on, and you don't be alone with him again. And the sexual assault person should go to jail. You go to the police with that one. And the moral equivalency of those two is a very, very bad thing for the country. A very bad thing for male-female relationships. You are listening to The Andy Hoosier Show on KQAM 1480 and 102.5 FM. We'll see you after the break.
It's time for Reason.
They have really abused their power, saying, well, we're not going to tell you exactly how much money they used to. This is how much money we need to see for it to be, quote unquote, suitable. And that way you're constitutionally compliant. Nowadays, they say, yeah, you know what? We made a mistake back then. We're not allowed to tell you exactly how much because you do have the power of the purse, but only to some degree because we still get to tell you whether it's constitutional or not. So I can't tell you how much, but you need more money.
This is the Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Then I'll get on my knees and pray.
Herbert, I'm filling in for Andy Hoosier while he is hopefully somewhere sleeping in on vacation. If you'd like to talk this morning, the number is 316-721-8255 or 721-TALK. If you went to bed at a reasonable hour last night, you may not know that a Democrat won a U.S. Senate seat in Alabama. Doug Jones beat Roy Moore last night by 1.5 points. And we've been talking a little bit about that. So if you'd like to weigh in on that, feel free to do so. But we've moved on a little bit to the... I had mixed feelings about Roy Moore, obviously, like probably all humans. Well, all Republican humans. And so it's been with a little bit of relief that Roy Moore lost. I think the Republicans lost the battle, but there was no way we were winning it, no matter what the outcome of that election. And this loss of the battle, I think, is going to eventually help us win the war. So the biggest downfall of what occurred in Alabama is the war on men is about to kick up a notch. And as an ovary, as a person of ovary persuasion, I worry that men are going to be, I think it's going to be damaging to men. I think it's going to be damaging to women. And I think it's going to be damaging to relationships. I would hate to be single right now. I can't even imagine how hard it is for a man to, I would hate to be single right now because there is no way you can do it right. You touch a woman inappropriately. I don't mean inappropriately. That's the wrong word. If you touch a woman inappropriately, you're a creep show. So let's lay that out there. I mean, you touch a woman, you let your hand linger on her back. You're a single guy and you're, you know. Or you kiss her thinking that she is willing to accept your advance. You lean, if you will, if you've seen While You Were Sleeping. You lean, she leans, and you accept wanting or whatever. You have to see the movie. But even in those situations now, a man has to be concerned that he is potentially 40 years from now going to face allegations of sexual misconduct. I think it's a bad thing. And I'm not looking forward to seeing the war on men being kicked into high gear. We don't need it. We do not need it any more than what we've got. Some of these people, like Harvey Weinstein, completely, those allegations are sexual assault, but creepy guy who let us, even, God bless him, Al Franken, I think he's a sleazeball and a jerk. However, the allegations that he's facing are so far removed from what Harvey Weinstein is facing. He's a creep. He's a sleazeball. I wouldn't want to be alone with him. But Harvey Weinstein is accused of rape. And Al Franken is accused of putting his hands on women's butts. Should he have done it? Of course not. But they're not the same thing, and the moral equivalency there is a bad thing. But enough about that. I'm sick of the conversation. I think we're going to be having it a lot more frequently and more often. Let's talk about Kansas, because that's what I really love. specifically, what is going on in the governor's office and what is going on in the soon-to-be governor's office? I think this is important. We are, in all likelihood, about to have a new governor, as you know. Governor Brownback is likely to become the ambassador for religious liberty at the U.S. State Department. Congratulations. But when and if the Senate confirms him, Lieutenant Governor Jeff Collier is going to become governor. And I'm kind of looking forward to that, as I think most Kansans are. It's not that I'm upset about how Brownback has governed. It's mostly that, unfortunately, right now, he is an albatross. He's an albatross on Kansas Republicans. So it won't hurt my feelings to maybe get a little bit of a fresh start this session, because there are some very important things coming up in 2018 that I am very, very concerned about. And specifically, this is what I'm hearing. I lay awake at night worrying about Medicaid expansion. I know it's ridiculous, but every state that has tried it so far, cost overruns have been enormous. And once you, I think we've all learned that once you put a lot of people in an entitlement program, it is impossible to get rid of it or even pull it back. So Kansas can't afford it. But here's what I'm hearing about Lieutenant Governor Collier. Word on the street is that he's ready to cave on Medicaid expansion. It's a little bit of gossip, a little bit of reading the tea leaves, and I actually spoke to him at an event and kind of asked him, is this true? And I'm going to say I was not all that comforted by his answers. I don't feel like there was absolutely not. We're not expanding Medicaid. Not on my watch. I'll veto it. In my mind, that's what you say about that particular issue, because it is disastrous to the state budget and really to the state as a whole for a very long time. He kind of said, well, there might be a way for us to expand Medicaid without busting the budget, something like that. So there's kind of no more important issue to the future of Kansas and even the nation right now than Medicaid expansion. I'm not going to bore you with all the details of why that's true, but I'm going to say this. Getting involved, getting entwined in a long-term social welfare program is a terrible idea because of math. And getting in bed with the federal government for the promise of extra funding never ends well. Brownback is leaving, full stop. Unless someone in the Senate digs up a dead puppy scandal, Brownback is headed to Washington to fight for religious freedom, and that's best for all of us. Collier's going to be the next governor of Kansas for at least the next year, and if he wants to continue on in the role, here's where the things get tricky. Collier's going to have to distance himself from Brownback, and it's an unreasonable demand from a very uneducated public, but that's where we're at. Brownback's approving ratings are somehow lower than probably Roy Moore's. It's unrealistic, but that's where we're at. So Collier is running for governor in 2018, as he has announced, and I'm sure all you smart listeners know. And he's got to figure out a way to distance himself. He's got two choices. He can step to the right of Brownback, maybe by, here's what I would love to see. I'm not going to say it's going to happen, but maybe limiting some of Brownback's economic development tools like PEAK and STAR bonds. Those are economic development incentives that basically subsidize big businesses. So anyway. So that would, but doing that means no ribbon cuttings for things like horse arenas and KCK and medical clinics for state employees in Topeka, and possibly eliminating those things those incentives might mean fewer campaign checks from some of Kansas companies. So the clinic and the horse arena are already happening, but there are still lots of options for ribbon cutting. So the challenge for Collier is to find a way to distance himself from Brownback, and that's what I would like to see, move to the right, or maybe I would say that's maybe a libertarian move, but move in that direction. But if he steps right, the guy standing to the right of him in the gubernatorial race is Kris Kobach, and I really think Kris Kobach probably has the far right market all locked up. So Collier's either going to have to go big and go left, or he's going home at the end of 2018. And there's nothing bigger or lefter than Medicaid expansion on the table. Here's the crux. There aren't enough votes right now, or so I'm told, to override Medicaid expansion in the Kansas legislature. You'll recall last session, maybe you'll recall, Kansas legislature took up this issue, and it passed both the House and the Senate, but Brownback mercifully vetoed it. I mean, this was early. Probably we're looking at almost a year ago. It was early in the session, and the House did not have enough votes to override it. They were too short. We don't know what the Senate would do because the House didn't override the veto. It never went to them. I think they were 3 or 4 votes short on first passage, so there's a very tiny margin for error there, assuming Collier would veto it. There are a couple of options if they were to pick up Medicaid expansion again and pass it. Collier can allow it to become law without a signature, and I've heard that that's what he's willing to do, and I have a problem with this, a huge problem with this. I've heard that that's what he's willing to do, assuming the legislation has three magical things. I don't know what those things are. I've heard it might be some sort of limitation on people who can take Medicaid if they aren't working, for tying it to that, a federal waiver that would allow Kansas to tie Medicaid to work for able-bodied adults. Kansas already has welfare or work requirements for its welfare program, and that's actually paid some dividends. But Kansas isn't in control of whether the federal government grants that exemption or a waiver should Kansas choose to do that. So after the break, we're going to talk a little bit more about Medicaid expansion. It's not the sexiest topic, but it is one of the most important in the state right now, especially since the feds have failed to eliminate Obamacare. So we're going to talk about that after the break. I'd really love to hear from you, and I'd also like to give you some examples of who to put pressure on when it's time to get back to Topeka. There's a couple of lawmakers in your area that probably need to be nudged to do the right thing and vote against it. You're listening to 1480 AM and 102.5 FM KQAM. This is Danedri Herbert. I'm filling in for Andy Hoosier. After the break, I'd really love to hear from you. Our phone number here is 316-721-8255, 721-TALK. We'll see you on the other side.
This is the Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier on the Big Talker KQAM.
Christmas cookies, sugar. I sure do like those Christmas cookies.
Good morning. Babe. You are listening to the Voice of Reason, the Andy Hoosier Show on KQAM 1480 AM and 102.5 FM. My name is Danedri Herbert. Some of you out this way in Wichita may know me as Gidget Southway. We have been talking a little bit about Roy Moore. If you're just now joining us and you go to bed at a reasonable hour, you may not know that the Democrat in Alabama won a Senate seat last night for the first time in 25 years. And then we've also talked a little bit about Me Too, hashtag Me Too movement. But so if you want to weigh in on either of those topics, feel free to give us a call at 316-721-8255 or 721-TALK. I've kind of moved on from Me Too and Roy Moore because I'm sick of them, but I'm very interested in your thoughts. In the meantime, I want to talk about Lieutenant Governor Jeff Collier. He's about to be governor. He's going to need some pressure. Word on the street is that he is seriously considering expanding Medicaid, which is a disaster. I don't think I probably have to tell the listeners of this audience that every state that has expanded Medicaid has had ghastly cost overruns. We're talking 100%, 150% overruns. The estimated number of people who would glob on to Medicaid in Kansas is 150,000 able-bodied Kansans climbing on to the Medicaid rolls. We can't afford it. There's that. And it is all going to come down to Lieutenant Governor Jeff Collier because I think, as you may recall from last year, this legislature is very happy to spend money and tax you into oblivion. Medicaid expansion will be expensive. And this legislature, the exact same legislators coming back in January to Topeka, they voted last session to expand Medicaid and Brownback vetoed it. They did not have the votes to override his veto in the House. They were, I think, two votes short, if I remember correctly, maybe three. And we don't know about in the Senate, but I think in the initial vote that put Medicaid expansion on Governor Brownback's desk, I think they were only three or four votes short. So what Lieutenant Governor Collier does once he becomes governor is going to be a big deal. I think, as I mentioned before the break, well, and maybe I'm assuming this audience is pretty well tuned in and realizes that there are, at last count, I think 10 people running for governor on the Republican side of the aisle, and Lieutenant Governor Collier is one of those. So he's got a choice. He can kind of move, well, he has to distance himself from Brownback, and he can either do that by moving left, Medicaid expansion, or moving right. The challenge Collier faces is that if he moves right, he's got Kris Kobach standing over there, and I don't know how you move to the right of Kris Kobach. I'm not sure it's possible. Although I will say this, because I'm a fan of both of those gentlemen. So, assuming Collier isn't interested in expanding Medicaid, but what I just said goes out the window if he makes a deal to expand Medicaid. It is a disaster. But I don't know how you get to the right of Kris Kobach. So, the word on the street is that Collier is willing to expand Medicaid, assuming it has, or he's willing to allow a Medicaid expansion bill to become law without his signature, provided it has three magic requirements. I have no idea what those are. I can just guess what those three magic beans are. I've heard that one of those magic beans is a federal waiver that would allow Kansas to tie Medicaid to work for able-bodied adults. And I will say I have spoken, I think there's some truth to that. I'll just say that. I think the folks I've heard that from, I believe that there is some truth to that. Kansas already has work requirements for its welfare program, and that's actually paid pretty good dividends. But Kansas isn't, this is the whole problem with Medicaid expansion, other than I don't really believe in taking money from other people to pay for other people like it's socialism. That's my real problem. But on the other hand, one of the arguments that legislators are going to make come January or February, whenever this comes up in the Kansas House or the Kansas Senate or both, is that, well, the federal government pays for almost all of it. Well, Kansas isn't in control of what the federal government does. And we can't trust them to keep that promise to begin with, because they're not so good at keeping their promises in Congress in the first place. So let's talk about that after the break. Give me a call at 316-721-8255, 721-TALK. I'm Danedri Herbert, also known as Gidget Southway, filling in for Andy Hoosier on The Voice of Reason. See you in a few.
The holly green, the ivy green, the prettiest picture you've ever seen is Christmas in Killarney with all of the folks at home. It's nice, you know, to kiss your beau and cuddle in under the mistletoe. And Santa Claus, you know, of course, is one of the boys from home.
Good morning. You're listening to The Voice of Reason, The Andy Hoosier Show. I'm Danedri Herbert, filling in for Andy while I hope he is still sleeping in. I know I would be if I got up at this time every single morning. If you are just now joining us, you may not know that the Alabama elected a Democrat to the U.S. Senate last night. I'm so sick of the name Roy Moore. I can't hardly stand it. But if you would like to weigh in on what occurred, you can give us a call, 316-721-8255 or 721-TALK. We've also talked a little bit about the hashtag MeToo movement in response to Roy Moore, but I've also had quite enough of that. I'm sick of the war on men. I like dudes. I'm sorry. So I hate to see them all brought down without any due process, really. We're just supposed to believe the women, and I appreciate that you're just willing to believe whatever I say, but I'm not a fan. But most importantly, I want to take us into Kansas and talk about what's going to happen in January when the legislature goes back in session. I'm making an assumption here, but I think it's a good one, that we are going to have a new governor by the time the session starts the second week of January, I believe. The legislators go back to Topeka and hopefully leave us alone as much as humanly possible. However, they have some big issues on their plate, and I think there's an appetite for expanding Medicaid, which is a terrible idea, perhaps the worst in state history. And Lieutenant Governor Collier, who will likely be the governor by that time, as Brownback is slotted to take an appointment in the State Department under the Trump administration, Collier's likely to see a bill on his desk that expands Medicaid. Kansas is one of, I think, 11 states that haven't expanded Medicaid. At this point, I'm going off of memory, so don't quote me on the 11 states. We are one of a handful of states that has not expanded Medicaid, and every single state that has expanded Medicaid has been, their budgets are in the toilet. The Medicaid expansion has, you know, they estimate the number of people that will take them up on the Medicaid expansion, and it cost overruns, double the number of people as anticipated. And into this mix, the argument that the so-called mods in Kansas and in other states, the other state legislators have made this decision to expand Medicaid is that the federal government pays for 90% of it. I don't think it's smart to trust the federal government to do anything they say they are going to do. Because the challenging thing is it's not really up to one person. I mean, this is the challenge that the legislature in Kansas and any legislative body that is more than a party of one faces. No one person gets to make the decision. You are at the mercy in the federal government of 435 people in the U.S. House and 100 people in the Senate. And I think, as we saw in the Obamacare repeal debate just a few months ago, we can't count on even our own Republicans to do what they said they would do, which was repeal Obamacare, which is why we're now dealing with this Medicaid expansion thing again. And Lieutenant Governor Collier, the rumor is willing to entertain some Medicaid expansion possibilities. That's the rumor. We're going to take a call. Hello.
Hello.
You're on.
Yes. Oh, thank you. Say, nice lady, I have a question for you.
Okay, well, wait. First, tell me who you are.
My name is Eddie.
All right, Eddie. All right, go ahead, Eddie.
I have a question for you since you're a lady.
Okay. Good.
Now, I've been watching all this man-woman stuff going on for ever since for the past 70-some-odd years.
Yes.
And I've got a question for you.
Okay.
Now, it used to be normal for a man to pursue a woman, but it seems like any, especially if they're single, but it seems like any more that, good gosh, if a man says something to a woman, it's suddenly sexual harassment. And to be quite honest with you, these women these days, I think it's the poor guy that's getting chased more than anything else.
Well, this is one of the challenges with the hashtag MeToo thing and sexual harassment. And it is going, I mean, already the dynamics of male and female relationships have changed so much. I feel old fashioned saying this, but I kind of liked when I was single being pursued. And I have to think, I hate to call it biology because heaven knows I do not want to run into the, I don't want to be accused of being anti-science. But I do think there is a reason that for millennia, women have been the ones pursued traditionally and men have not. And I'm not saying women can't maybe make some inroads, but it bothers me already the amount of, well, I think you, I don't know if you're familiar with Tinder or any of these online dating sites.
No.
Well, good for you.
I haven't dated in about 40 some years.
Well, these dating sites, there's nothing wrong with them, but the people meet online and then they meet somewhere in person and then they pay Dutch. And I, as a woman, it does not hurt my feelings when a man picks up the chick. I'm just going to say it. I'm sorry, feminists. I like working outside the home and all of the things that feminism has brought us. However, there are a few things that I like it when men are gallant. I like it when they open the door. I like it when I feel like I'm going to be protected if a fight breaks out, or I like that.
Absolutely. It's about time some good old-fashioned lady gets on instead of the darn thing. You know, I was at a Quick Trip the other day.
Yes.
And I opened up a door for a lady. I bet she was about 19, 20 years old, and she looked at me and she said, "That's sweet of you." And I thought, oh, that's kind of you to say that, because
yeah, you almost
I don't
have
know.
To be afraid to do it now.
Oh, hell, I'm not afraid to do it. You know what? I'm not going to change. I am who I am, and I have been all of my life. Anyway, getting back to this, I think it's just plumb crazy what's going on. Now, sexual harassment is sexual harassment. That's totally against everything, but
right.
Wow.
They're two different things. That's been one of the big problems with this Me Too, hashtag Me Too movement, is that it's not very well defined. Like, some people are saying Me Too, meaning they've been sexually assaulted, and that is a crime. Or they have been sexually harassed by their boss, and they have felt compelled to behave in ways they wouldn't because they were concerned about losing their job. That is another thing. And then there's the people who are like, he tried to kiss me. I'm not saying it's okay, but if you, I feel like, who is that woman who said during the Bill Clinton stuff, which was just appalling to me, the one touch rule, which was whatever that was. Who said that? Anyway, the one touch rule. But, you know, if somebody tries to kiss you and you do not like your advance and you say, no, don't touch me, and they leave you alone. I'm not saying it, and they're not your boss. There's some gray, you know. Does Me Too mean that, or does it mean rape? They're two different things.
I don't know.
And the moral equivalency of them is going to make it very difficult for male and female relationships. Children are going to cease to exist because I do not know how men and women meet each other and have any kind of dialogue that leads to any kind of meaningful relationship after all of this it runs its course. I really worry. I sincerely worry. Well, Eddie, thank you so much for calling. Do you live in Wichita?
Oh, absolutely, ma'am. Do you live in Wichita? Hey, did you grow up here in Wichita?
No, I'm from Gardner, Kansas, which is over by Kansas City.
Beautiful. Welcome to a beautiful part of the country. Take care.
I
bye-bye.
I really like it here. Thank you so much for your call. I love hearing from what I would call seasoned citizens. I do suspect the the gender wars have been going on for quite some time, and I'm not sure. I don't know if they've gotten better or worse. I really can't decide. I don't want to go back to the time when I couldn't work outside the. I like working outside the home. I like working with men. I like being able to be an active working member of society in a way that is not. I know my mom, for example. I used to be a flight attendant. Right after college, I was a flight attendant for several years. Anyway, my mom, I lived with a couple of girls, women, who were pilots. And my mom was fascinated by this because she says when she grew up, that just wasn't a job that women did. Like, you just, she literally was fascinated by it. She was like, women couldn't do this. It wasn't, and now we can. I mean, you can go be a pilot. You can go be a doctor, a neurosurgeon, a train engineer, a construction worker. Women can do and are encouraged to be involved in every industry and every facet. And 99% of the time, my one exception is the infantry. I don't think women should be in the infantry. I'll just say it out loud. 99% of the time, I think it's a great thing. And I'm so grateful that I'm living in that time. But at the same time, there's a little bit of me that longs for a well-defined way that male-female relationships work. I don't know that I ever saw that time. My best example is like Mad Men, which I think was terrible for women, the time of Mad Men in a lot of ways. But in some ways, you knew, well, no. I just wish the battle of the sexes was defined in a way that at least in relationships, meaningful relationships that lead to family and lead to long-term, sustainable, meaningful family units, I wish there was a little more definition there. It's gotten very confusing, and there are a lot of days that I am so glad that I am not single and that I haven't been for about 10 years. Anyway, with that, I want to come back to a few more words about Medicaid expansion and Lieutenant Governor Jeff Collier when we come back after the break. You're listening to The Voice of Reason on 1480 AM and 102.5 FM KQAM. My name is Danedri Herbert, and we'll see you on the other side.
The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
You're listening to The Voice of Reason, the Andy Hoosier Show on 1480 AM and 102.5 FM KQAM. My name is Danedri Herbert, and I'm filling in for Andy Hoosier, and I would just like it known that I did not pick that bump music. I don't know what that was, but it sounded like some kind of metal Christmas horror show, and I would like to formally apologize for that.
I as the producer of today's show, that is not me either. We can lay that blame 100% solely on Mr. Andy Hoosier.
Okay.
Right?
I kind of figured he has terrible taste in music.
No, hey, I give him that. He's got some good taste in music, but the holiday line, you know, the holiday music, hey, some of it's pretty cool, but, you know, I miss the old Burl Ives, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. I mean, how many times have we seen that in our lifetimes?
I'm just going to say this. My favorite Christmas music... I'm glad we brought this up. My favorite Christmas music is all of the Christmas hymns, and it makes me sad that we never hear them. That was an abomination, whatever that was. Somebody screaming and about it was terrible.
Yeah, that's they're like you said, that was one of those liberal snowflakes. As I grab my liberal towel here, that they needed something they had nothing to complain about, so they had to pick something, and you picked the oldest, you know, most celebrated holiday in this country next to the 4th of July, and you want to complain about that. You know, next thing you know, they're going to say, no, we can't shoot off fireworks. Oh, wait a minute. We've already had that argument.
I was going to say, I don't know about Wichita. I'm from Johnson County. You're not allowed to shoot off fireworks in most of Johnson County.
Well, I'm originally from born and raised in Springfield, Missouri, and you're not allowed to shoot them off in the city limits. But the state of Missouri's fireworks regulations are totally different than the state of Kansas.
I know.
You get the good stuff. As in, to take a line from Joe Dirt, the movie Joe Dirt, you get the good stuff in Missouri.
I suppose that's true. And now I want to take us back to Kansas and away from Christmas, although it is a magical time of year and one of my favorites. We've been talking, if you are just now joining us, we have talked a little bit about Roy Moore. We've talked a little bit about the hashtag Me Too. And I want to talk about a particular passion of mine, which isn't a sexy topic, but it's an important one. Medicaid expansion, which is going to be a huge issue come January, when the Kansas legislature goes back into session. And the biggest concern right now is Lieutenant Governor Jeff Collier is probably about to take over the role as governor. And there's a little bit of a question mark on whether or not he will veto Medicaid expansion if and when it crosses his desk. And I firmly believe it will cross his desk. We have a legislature. Those of you who follow politics, which I'm assuming most of you who are listening right now do, know that we have a little bit of although our Kansas legislature is majority Republican, we have a lot of Republicans who seem to oppose everything on the Republican platform who are currently, we have a lot of those folks in office. One of the planks of the Republican Party, the Kansas Republican Party platform, is the Kansas Republican Party platform expressly opposes Medicaid expansion. It reads, I'm going to read it to you because we have people who call themselves Republicans who, number one, can't list a single thing on the Republican Party platform or the Kansas Republican Party platform, and they don't ascribe to any of it. So here's what the Kansas Republican Party platform says about Medicaid expansion. We ask that the governor and or legislators refrain from expanding Medicaid and other federal health care programs. About half of the Kansas Republican legislators didn't receive that memo. They are dying to expand Medicaid. Even as many privately admit that it is terrible policy that will bankrupt the state. So the rumor that I have been hearing for a while now is that Collier is willing to allow Medicaid expansion to occur without his signature. You know, once a bill passes the House and passes the Senate, it goes to the governor's desk and he has the choice to allow it to become law without his signature, veto it, or sign it. And I have heard that Collier is entertaining the idea of allowing Medicaid expansion to pass as long as it has three things that he is requiring of this legislation should it pass his desk. Now, I don't know what those three things are. I'm peddling rumors here a little bit, but whatever the three things are, one of them is supposedly a work requirement for those receiving able-bodied people receiving Medicaid. Whatever the other two magic beans are make Lieutenant Governor Collier feel okay with allowing that to become law, I don't know. But I think expanding Medicaid in any way, shape, or form is a disastrous plan for the state. As most of you listeners know, Kansas is one of a handful of states that hasn't expanded it. The rest of the states who have, their budgets are underwater. You think the Kansas budget has been bad the last couple of years? Go look at some of those states that expanded Medicaid and see what happened to their budget. It takes money from everything else, and we've already got a shortfall in the next couple of years. You're listening to The Andy Huser Show on KQAM 1480 and 102.5 FM. See you on the other side.
It's time for Reason.
They have really abused their power, saying, well, we're not going to tell you exactly how much money they used to. This is how much money we need to see for it to be, quote-unquote, suitable, and that way you're constitutionally compliant. Nowadays, they say, yeah, you know what? We made a mistake back then. We're not allowed to tell you exactly how much because you do have the power of the purse, but yeah, only to some degree because we still get to tell you whether it's constitutional or not. So I can't tell you how much, but you need more money.
This is the Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Then I'll get on my knees.
Over said, this is the Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier, but I am not Andy Hoosier. I'm Danedri Herbert, filling in while Andy is on vacation, and I meant to mention this earlier and forgot. I have a guest this hour. J.R. Clayes is a representative from Salina. He's a Republican. We usually appreciate his votes. Every once in a while, he's taken a few that give me pause, but he's going to talk a little bit about what we can expect when the session starts. And J.R., are you on?
Yes, absolutely. Thanks for having me this morning, Danedri.
Hey, thanks for giving me a call. I appreciate it, or for agreeing to join me this morning. So I do want to tell the audience that I have known JR. I used to call him Jeremy because that's what he went by in college. We knew each other at K-State. He was actually my boss at the radio station, and that's about all I remember.
Yeah.
So,
oh, man,
and now
that was a long time
he's in the
ago.
Kansas legislature. They have given him a little bit of power, which I... questionable. I have a feeling you're going to see JR run for higher offices eventually. I know for certain, I heard rumors that people got a poll asking whether they would vote for JR in a race for the second congressional district, which is odd since he lives in Salina, but there was a poll taken. How'd you do in that poll?
Yeah.
Do you know? Have you heard?
Yeah, no, I'm not the commissioner of said poll, but yeah, some strange things afoot there, but put that rumor to rest.
So you're not running anywhere. For the second congressional district?
No.
Okay.
No, I'm.
What about the first?
Quite happy where I am.
What about the first?
No, not that one either.
Okay, I just want to be clear. I believe you.
You're doing that journalism trick where you pause and create awkward silence and hope that I fill it.
I
know your game.
So you're trying to tell me you're too smart for that?
Yeah, I think so.
We'll see about that. So let's, first of all, we have been talking a little bit about Medicaid expansion because I keep hearing rumors that Lieutenant Governor Jeff Collier, when he becomes Governor Collier, might be willing to allow a Medicaid expansion bill to slide past his desk without his signature, allowing it to become law. How are you going to vote
well,
on that?
Yeah, I mean, that seems like the... kind of the MO of the Brownback Collier administration and the co-governors that we have currently.
Man, you are harsh on those two.
Awkwardly.
I appreciate their efforts, but go
on. They act awkwardly in tandem. But that's the MO. I mean, when Brownback sold out our Second Amendment rights, it was the same thing. I'll just let this thing kind of go unsigned. And, you know, I would fully expect something similar.
Oh my goodness, JR, this is not what I expected to hear from you, truly.
No. Well, I mean, Medicaid expansion is an extremely costly thing to do, and it also, you know, flies in the face of what Medicaid was designed for in the first place, which was to cover those who can't take care of themselves. I mean, quite literally, those who can't take care of themselves, and now we're expanding that to cover able-bodied adults, and that makes absolutely zero sense in terms of what the program is designed to do. So take a step back and let's look at the arguments for it. And the claims are that all these hospitals will close. Well, if you're really concerned about propping up hospitals through whatever socialist system you want to design, then why not just create direct payments? It's less expensive. Just feed them cash. Let's not go through this guise of, you know, oh, hospitals will close if we don't expand Medicaid and the money will trickle down. I mean, I thought liberals hated that trickle-down stuff, but they certainly love it when it comes to Medicaid expansion. They really believe that that's the panacea for rural health care, and it just simply is not.
Well, can you tell me, how did you, do you remember, I know this came up last session, and if I, it was almost two-thirds, is that correct? How'd you vote on it?
Yeah, it was in the 80s. Oh, I voted against.
Good job.
It was in the 80s, so it didn't quite reach the veto proof. I don't think it may have. I don't know.
No, I don't. It
84
didn't.
Is our
because the Brownback actually vetoed it, and it didn't. The House you guys didn't override the veto, so it never even got to the next step to the Senate to see if they would override. So, well, I'm glad to hear you're not on board with Medicaid expansion. I'm very, very concerned about it. I think it's terrible for the budget, and considering you got what's going on with school finance, there's not that we could afford it before, but we definitely can't afford it now. What's going on with school finance? What are you hearing?
Right. So step back another step, and let's look at the last tax plan that went through. I also voted against that.
Thank you.
But the idea that this was a solution, and all of these folks who ran on this idea that, oh, I'm going to go solve all the great problems of our day, which includes giant tax hikes retroactively, those folks passed a budget and tax plan that goes insolvent again in 2 years.
Right. It's a disaster.
They solved zero. And by the way, at the exact same time, continue to sweep all the KDOT sales tax money, continue to delay CAPERS payments. The idea that this solved anything is completely false. And now you've got, if you read the tea leaves, about $650 million that the court is demanding for schools, or they're going to close them.
So
they haven't been as overt with this group about closing schools, but $650 million is more than what the tax hike just was.
I know.
In case anyone's keeping score. Yeah.
I am keeping score.
It's more.
I have a list of people who voted for it that I intend to mention at some point very soon that live right here.
So let's look at then.
Anyway.
So that $650 million, let's say the group passes another tax hike that's more than what they just passed. They will continue to sweep all the money out of KDOT.
Oh,
they will continue to delay CAPERS payments, and we will continue to head into insolvency once again. So by the way, they all want Medicaid expansion. So, you know, add another $400 million. The idea that you can do all of these things in a state where we would have higher tax rates than California, Massachusetts, I don't see it. We can't afford those things, and we have to be a lot more selective about the things that we do decide that we're going to do as a government. If we're going to provide a service, we have to provide it well. We have to do the things that we do really well and not be an inch deep and a mile wide.
Well, tell me this. Are you hearing? I'll tell you what I have heard is kind of the direction that House leadership is wanting to go with this kind of what I would call a court showdown. I have heard, and I don't know if it's true, so I'm spreading rumors again. I have heard that the goal is kind of to attempt a constitutional amendment that would define what the word suitable means. Have you heard that? And is that something you're willing to entertain?
Sure, but I think it would be largely meaningless with this court. There are other states that have lawsuits on school finance that don't have the word suitable in their constitution.
Right.
There are other states where this happens, and the court usurps the power of the purse from the legislative branch and the power of the executive from the executive branch, and goes through this process where they force more dollars primarily in education spending. I don't know that it would help.
How do we end? How do we get to a ceasefire in this? I know as a taxpayer, and even as a person interested in taxes and policies, I'm kind of sick of this. I've had enough of talking about it. There doesn't seem to be a dollar amount that will ever appease them. So at some point,
$650 million.
For now.
That might appease them.
For now.
Yeah. But we're not talking about the other side of the coin, too, and that's the equity portion that they've created out of thin air. That also requires many, many Johnson County legislators to vote against their own interests to take tax dollars from that county.
As a Johnson County person, I will tell you there are plenty of Johnson County legislators completely willing to do that, and they appear to have some support from their constituents. I don't think Representative Melissa Rooker is going to... She's fine with the equity. She appears to be okay with the take money from my Shawnee and Blue Valley schools and send it out west. So they do need some Johnson County legislators to climb on, but I don't think they're going to have that much trouble finding them. Do you?
I think it'll be a little harder than what it will take to override a veto. And let's say that co-governor Collier or if Brownback still
to
around.
Stop. It's going to be Governor Brownback. Collier
I won't.
By then.
I absolutely won't. Who knows? I mean, we really don't know that for sure.
Right.
We may have a state of the state from Brownback and have Collier defending that budget through the process. Who knows? But let's say, you know, co-governor Collier goes through this process and he decides he's going to veto those things. Do we hit that 84 number? Do you hit 27 in the Senate? And I don't see that being the case when it comes to equity portion, because there are so many losers in that process.
I kind of think all of the legislators should just plan on moving to Topeka permanently, because I don't see how you guys ever get out of there this session. And
well,
it's
here's what ends up happening.
Okay, yeah. Tell me where.
I mean,
my guess,
because you have a lot of the moderates who have drawn their line in the sand and said, "I'm not going to raise taxes again."
I've heard that.
My one vote. I'm not.
I don't
doing
believe
it again.
Them, but okay.
That. Yeah, I don't believe it either. So they're looking at the 650 number. So do you get a group of moderates who will vote for 300, 350? And then toss that at the court and say, you know, here's what we tried, you know, at least give us a reprieve for another year. And they say, oh, well, it's April. Yeah, let's go ahead and accept that as step one. And
do
you
think the court accepts that? I mean, it's hard to read. Well, it's not that hard to read those tea leaves. I can't believe, I really thought they were going to be fine with what happened with the new finance formula. It's not that different from the old formula. So
It's not that different, but the equity side of it is where I think they really started getting a lot of heartburn, and then of course overall wanting more money consistently throughout. But the equity issue and allowing more local dollars to be spent with more local control, which is kind of strange to be hearing, because you've heard the drumbeat from moderates and liberals that conservatives want to take away local control, and you know, really this whole process is all about local control. It's about you and parents and taxpayers and having that power to decide how their children's education looks, especially when we demand that you must go to this school in area because it's near where you live. We wouldn't do anything else like that.
I need to stop you there. We're coming back after the break, but we got to take one right now so that the bills get paid. We will see you on the other side of this. You're listening to The Voice of Reason, the Andy Hoosier Show. Hopefully it's obvious. I'm not Andy. I'm Danedri. But we'll see you on the other side of this break. We're still going to be on with JR in just a couple minutes.
You're listening to The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier.
Good morning. You're listening to The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier. I'm Danedri Herbert, and we are here talking with J.R. Clays, the Republican representative from Salina, who, in my opinion, is maybe being a tad too harsh on Governor Brownback and Lieutenant Governor Collier. But he and I are trying to work through how the legislature is going to end the school finance wars. the court standoff is what I would call it. J.R., are you there still?
Yes, and I'm gonna say something nice about the Brownback Collier co-governorship.
Oh.
I will.
Okay,
There's one group they haven't sold out, and that is the folks who are pro-life like me. And I truly appreciate the gains that we've made in the pro-life movement in the state of Kansas since Brownback Collier were elected.
You sound like a politician right now. You're
aiming
for the KFL endorsement, aren't you?
I always get the KFL endorsements. They're a great group of folks, but it is one of those issues where we really made some tremendous gains since Sebelius and the culture of death that those folks created in Kansas.
Why do you, I know on the gun thing? Why you feel like there was a little bit of a sellout there? But what else do you feel like has been sold?
It's not a little bit. Okay. I mean, you have a right to defend yourself, and someone takes that away at the doorstep. That's absolutely wrong, and it goes against everything that we fought for, at least since I've been in 6 years ago when I started this. And to have that taken away by a governor or co-governors or whoever's governor, to have that taken away by someone who says that they're okay. in favor of your Second Amendment rights, ran on that, went after those endorsements, said time and again that that's who they are.
So
it goes to their core.
My understanding...
And then to be absolutely unprincipled and just let that thing become law.
I'm not making excuses because I took issue with that decision. However, my understanding, and this has been my complaint about Governor Brownback all along, he's just too nice. Like I think he was trying to play nice with the hospital folks so that the St. Francis deal went through. Which
yeah,
at the time,
get people on the other side to like him, and that's what ends up giving you a 25% approval rate because
right.
you sell out your base.
Right.
In order to get some liberals to like you, and that doesn't work.
No,
we've seen
it doesn't.
That time again.
Which is my big concern with Collier on Medicaid expansion. Like, they are never going to like you. I don't care what you do. I do think in this governor's race,
right.
somebody is going to emerge as the not Kobach candidate. But I don't think Collier is even going to be able to draw the so-called mods. I feel like there's some... so-called mods who aren't leaving the race.
Anyone who feels like they need to run positive ads in December of 2017 for an election in August of 2018
you are so
is doing extremely poorly.
You are so harsh. You are
in
so
fact,
harsh.
I would guess it's sub 3%, and name ID is dismally low. So, yeah, I mean,
I
don't know many... I don't know many who spend $208,000 on TV ads this far out.
Are you sure that's what it costs? Ouch.
I'm positive. $208,000 is Kansas City Cable, and then it's networks in Topeka and Wichita. All of that's public information. You can go look up.
I figured,
the state government leadership fund that it was funneled through.
Did you look it up? Yes, you did.
I did. It's a 501c4, and yeah, they funnel the money, and voila, you get an ad.
Well,
yep.
Okay, let's talk school finance wars, because my hope is that our lieutenant governor is not going to move left on that. What, first of all, do you think the court is okay with the $300 million or whatever the legislature can come up with to throw at schools, another $300 million, or do they sign off on that?
I think that's really the only way out. And remember, this deadline's earlier. It has to be done by the
April.
End of April, I
right.
believe.
Yeah.
So in the past, they've always kicked it into June.
All right. Hold up. We're going to come right back with that because we've got to take a break.
Sure.
Right back with that at the end of the hour. You're listening to The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier. See you on the other side.
You're down and lonely. All the angels on the way, I'm in the dirt. Hear me screaming, see me bleeding. Just a taste for more to say.
You're listening to The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier. I'm Danedri Herbert. We're on the line with J.R. Clays, a Republican representative from Salina. And we were just getting going. I had asked him, will the court, the Kansas Supreme Court, settle up with the legislature for $300 million? That's his prediction, that the legislature is going to try and piece together a little bit of an increase with money laying around under the sofa cushions and send that to the court and see what happens. J.R., will the court accept that?
When you say sofa cushions, what you really mean is taxpayers' wallets, because
right,
it will take a tax hike.
I think they'll pull from, I don't know.
There's nowhere left. The current budgets pull everything that's in the sofa cushions, and we've gone rifling through them every time to try to prop up a budget and tax
is
plan that has
any
zero
reasonable
cuts in it.
This is the frustrating part for me. So I know that we do have some needs, like I know our prisons are kind of short staffed, and maybe we need some, and we have some needs that we have been. Everything gets run over by the school lobby. I'll just say that we've taken money from everybody
yeah.
else to feed the school lobby beast, and it's not fair to the other state. They're trying to provide services too, and I would argue some. maybe they're not providing services as well as they could. And in the meantime, the schools are just, I'm not sure they're providing great services, but they keep asking for more and more money. And the more and more money we give them, the less there is to give to anybody else or anything else. So,
yeah, it's hard to take it real seriously when you see the amount of construction going on in our schools and the amount of money that's being poured into them. But to step back and go back to your point of other agencies having difficulty, you know, we do have prison escapes. We are experiencing riots. We are extremely short-staffed. We have 35-36% turnover at Lansing Correctional. We have in the 40s at El Dorado. There are significant concerns about public safety when things like that are happening, and not just public safety, but let's go back into the prisons where you have a guard that doesn't have a backup and what that looks like, or a guard that has a backup that's on the 15th hour of a 16-hour shift.
Right.
And what that looks like and the danger there. And do you wait to respond until someone dies? And there are things you can't undo. And I would advocate for fixing this problem before it gets to that stage, before that escapee commits a heinous crime, before you have a riot in a prison that ends up with casualties.
Well, tell me this, how much do you need for that?
Well, every percent increase in wages in the Department of Corrections for corrections officers is roughly $1 million.
Whoa.
So if you wanted to increase pay 5%, that's $5 million. 5% of 14 bucks, though, really isn't a huge pay increase.
So you think the turnover is the pay? I mean, I would not want to be a prison guard. I don't care what they pay. But
well, everybody has $14 a price. $14 an hour is not going to
entice somebody to work nights and weekends and in a potentially dangerous role, especially when
we've allowed the dominoes to fall to where they have, to the point that you're being required 12-hour shifts. Yeah. You're occasionally being pushed into 16-hour shifts. How long are you going to do that for 14 bucks an hour?
Right.
And how long can we sustain that? And the answer is we can't, and we haven't, and it's not working, and the disasters befall us all summer long as we see article after article about prison riots and escapes at Lansing.
But how can you, how can the legislature even address those issues when you have this school lobby and court battle that want, I mean, $650 million is... I can't remember, is it the Kansas Association of School Boards or the Kansas State Board of Education? One of them has said it's $1 billion. They want their ransom is $1 billion. That's a doubling of the 20 mils, near doubling of the 20 mils, a ridiculous sales tax hike or a ridiculous California, Massachusetts style income tax. How can we pay that ransom and still fund the other things that we need to fund?
And the answer is you can't. We kind of alluded to that earlier, that a $650 million tax hike or to your point, maybe even $1 billion in the eyes of some, and the number isn't specific.
Right,
I'm saying 650 because that's what I keep hearing that we've done. Yeah, that's kind of what we've all sort of read into the ruling. But let's say that it is 650, you could raise taxes 650, which would be more than what your taxes were just hiked, and you would still have each and every one of these problems that sits in front of us. And our highway program, remember, it's being bonded right now for maintenance.
No, I know.
You know, these things are happening just to keep the system from falling apart, and we really can't do that again. So there are things that are one-time sort of fixes here that aren't we're just not capable of doing them again and again to patch this up.
Tell me a little bit about efficiencies, because it seems like there are some rooms for efficiencies, but to get the biggest bang for the buck, there are efficiencies that affect the schools. I'm talking group procurement,
health insurance.
Mm-hmm. Like I've heard those. I mean, those are worth some big dollars, according to the legislative study from 2 years ago. Big dollars, big efficiencies that would free up some cash somewhere else. is there any chance that those are going to be looked at? I mean, seriously looked at?
So this is the Alvarez and Marcel study, and this was 2 years ago that we went through and commissioned that and started through that process.
Yes.
And there are a lot of structural things and procedural things that folks out there don't know about. And the issue with the Alvarez and Marcel study is that we had Alvarez and Marcel in when we initially did that, and we were able to get some things passed.
Yeah.
But this last session, when we went through and we started talking about Alvarez and Marcel study items, we didn't have Alvarez and Marcel available to us. They stopped paying Alvarez and Marcel. They didn't ask them to come in and defend those items. So instead, it was just a low-hanging pinata that got whacked by lobbyists all session long with no one there to defend it. And you would have to just simply acquiesce because there's no one there to say, here's the rationale behind this item. Here's how we came to this conclusion. None of that was available to us, and you had a wildly new legislative body with the number of moderates who were elected and Democrats, too. There were some gains there. So you had people who had never heard of this thing.
Right.
And their first experience with it is that it's just getting beat up by lobbyists, and there's no one defending it. So a lot of it just sort of, that's never going to happen. So we do have some challenges there, and you're right, some of the bigger items, I think it's somewhere in the $90 million range for group health insurance through the state plan for teachers, essentially, school staff, so that they don't have individual plans throughout the state. But you get a lot of pushback from places like Wichita.
Sure.
Wichita's health insurance plan is what's commonly referred to as a Cadillac plan, and other school districts don't have that kind of plan. So they would see a downgrade in their health insurance plan.
Well, is there a way to carve
as generous?
Is there a way to carve them out somehow? I know there's a couple of school districts that actually they have their own health plan. Like that, you know,
right?
They're just flat out their own, not part of a. And is there a way to carve them out? Is that an option?
So right now,
we actually state funding doesn't go to that. I mean, is that an option?
Well. Good luck with that. But right now we allow school districts to opt into the state plan. So there's nothing stopping them from doing it now, except that they don't want to spend money on it. I can't tell you how many times I've heard from school district folks who think they're explaining away low teacher pay, who say, well, we run through the entire budget, and then, you know, at the end, whatever's left over, that's what we do for teachers. So teachers are the afterthought in that process, and that's troubling.
No, you know who's the afterthought in the whole process? The kids, the teachers.
Well, yeah.
There's whatever the administration wants, and then probably whatever the football coach wants, depending on where you're from, and then maybe whatever the teachers union wants, and then the actual teachers, and then finally at the very end, they're like, oh yeah, we have all these kids we got to do something with. We need them to be able to read.
Yeah.
The lowest on the totem pole. Oh, the hierarchy.
That's probably even more accurate than my statement. But yes, the afterthought in the budget process, however, tends to be that last item on the list is here's what we have left over. And it's an unfortunate consequence of the way that we've set these things up. But the benefits packages, they generally don't have the dollars to opt into the state plan because it ends up being more expensive and more generous than the plan that they're offering.
Oh, interesting. Well, I'm going to cut you off.
Yeah, so they see it as a hike in costs.
In costs. Well, I'm going to cut you off here because we need to take another quick break. And at the end of the hour, we will finish it up to figure out what you guys can do to not rob us blind, us being the taxpayers, next session. You're listening to The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier. Obviously, I'm not Andy. I'm Danedri. He's on vacation. You are listening to 1480 AM and 102.5 FM KQAM. We will see you on the other side of this break in just a few minutes. Back with J.R. Clays, the Republican from Salina.
The Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier on the Big Talker KQAM.
Voice of Reason with Andy Hoosier. I am not Andy. I'm Danedri Herbert filling in while he's on vacation. I have J.R. Clays on the line, and we don't have much time. J.R. is a representative from Salina, one of the good ones, a Republican, and he is trying to tell us what we can expect from what is sure to be a train wreck in Topeka in the January 2018 legislative session. J.R., so we've determined that no one is going to be happy with whatever happens. If you got to wave a wand and choose what happened, how you dealt with the courts, what and the school finance, what do you do? Where do you go?
Sure. So I alluded earlier to there are some process things that people aren't really aware of and probably could care less about. But I'll talk a little bit about the legislative branch and what we've done to sort of require that the executive and the judicial branch do things that make our jobs possible. And one of those things is that we require our governor to give us a budget at the beginning of the session that balances.
Sure.
And that may seem like it's simple, you know, hey, it's a balanced budget, here you go.
Right.
One thing it cannot do, it cannot have revenue sources in it. It must be based off of current resources. We call it a current resources budget.
Okay.
Since I have been in the legislature, the co-administration of Brownback Collier has not delivered a current resources budget. They do not show us where they would cut if they had to. And remember, all of these agencies are under the executive. We're there for 3 months.
Right.
They are there. They appointed these people. They have their cabinet secretaries. They have access to them year round to be able to discuss with them what's working, what isn't, where can we find efficiencies, where would we cut if we had to. And when they don't do that and instead violate the law and send us a budget that says, here, hike tobacco taxes. Here, we'll sweep some money from the CIF. When they do that, they are making sure that we have absolutely no roadmap to be able to institute a cut. None. And that is why you have not seen any cuts in your budgets for any of these agencies as we've gone through this process for the past 6, 7, 8 years. Because when we've been able to have those discussions, there is nothing in front of us that says Department of Agriculture has 22 programs and these two are no longer effective. They're obsolete. We need to get rid of them. We don't have that. And as legislators who are there for 3 months, you're not being represented well because you don't have that roadmap for your legislator to follow. It's absolutely imperative that we have a leader in the governor's mansion. I don't believe that's going to be anyone associated with the Brownback Collier administration. I also believe that we need agency heads who are competent, who understand their role, who actually go in and look at these budgets,
look at these programs. I hear what you're saying, and I don't disagree with you. I don't disagree with you 100%. I'll say that. I think you're being maybe a little harsh on Brownback and Collier. And I have to ask, is that because you've picked a horse in the governor's race?
Well, I mean, obviously I have my preferences of who I would like to see in the governor's mansion. And it includes people who would do things like this, lead.
Okay.
We don't have someone in there who is leading. We don't have a plan going forward. We have people who sit back and say, well, we'll see what the legislature does, providing us absolutely none of the data we need to make those decisions. And then laying it off on us like, well, we'll just see what they do.
So this is what
I'm wondering why things like a tax plan don't work. We had a tax plan that could have worked if cuts were available to us.
Yes.
But when you hamstring us by not giving us those options, we're left to go do things like the A&M study. Right. We had to do that because no one else would.
Okay, so what I'm maybe hearing a little bit of, and I thought this the end of last session, was that some of this, I firmly believe that some of what happens policy-wise is maybe more related to almost personalities than it is to what is best policy. I'm not accusing you of that. I'm just saying, like, especially not you, actually. Anybody who voted no on that tax increase is not operating on emotion. But I felt like some of the people who at the last minute all of a sudden campaigned as we're not going to raise taxes and then did. I could list names, but I won't. I feel like some of that was based on personality. Brownback made them mad and they were done. Is that what happens there? I mean, do we need to send maybe people who are less emotional?
Well, I hope not. I hope not. I think people really do take into account, you know, the folks in their district and what the impact is of legislation on them. But I also think that there is this desire to get something done because we can't be there all year. And we do have to leave eventually with some solution. And I think at some point when you're dealing with a governor who simply says no to everything, you have to get 84 votes. And that's what they went after. And they found it.
Okay. Quick prediction. When are you out of Topeka this year? What day?
Well, we have an April 30th deadline for the courts, so
right.
I don't think it drags on as long as people might think, but I would imagine that it hits June again.
That's my guess too, and this raises a difficulty because you guys can't fundraise or campaign while you're
no, it definitely is an advantage to self-funded candidates.
So is that you?
Well, I mean, there are plenty of self-funded candidates out there. I mean, I certainly put my own skin in the game when I run for office, but I think there are plenty of others who do too. And it is an advantage to those who do that.
All right. Well, hey, I really appreciate your time, JR. You have given us a lot to think about, and you've been meaner to the governor than I would have liked, but that's okay. We're still friends.
He's a great pro-life governor.
He is.
I'll give him that.
All right. Well, thank you for your time. We will catch you later. Hey, Wichita, thanks for having me on today. You are listening to The Voice of Reason once again with Andy Hoosier. I'm Danedri. I filled in. Thank you, Andy, for the opportunity. Thanks for listening.